See, today I am going to speak on Kashmir. I am not going to speak about Article 370 and the ruckus that is presently taking place on that. My speech will be confined to the accession of Kashmir to India on 26 October 1947 and its immediate aftermath, which culminated in the ceasefire of 31st December 1948. Kashmir, in fact, was ruled by Hindus and Hindu and Buddhist dynasties until the 14th century when the Muslims took over. It was later conquered by Akbar in the 16th century. Till 1752, it was with the Mughal dynasty when Ahmad Shah Abdali invaded Kashmir and took over the reign. So the Pathans ruled Kashmir until I think 1819, when Maharaja Ranjit Singh conquered Kashmir. After the death of Maharaja of Ranjit Singh, the Sikh wars took place, and as you know, the Sikhs lost the war. So there was a treaty with the British. During that time, the Maharaja was asked to pay 1 crore rupees to the British, but the Sikh kingdom was almost bankrupt and they didn't have enough money. But the then Maharaja of Jammu, Gulab Singh, he offered to pay the money. The negotiations took place and the British did not want to give away the present day the Himachal Pradesh portions like Kulu Manali and Lahul Spiti. These areas, they kept them with themselves. So they reduced the cost to 75 lakhs. So the Treaty of Amritsar was signed. By the treaty, Gulab Singh became the ruler of Kashmir. This happened in 1847 or 48, I don't remember. Yeah, one of these 2 years. By way of interest, the treaty also said the Maharaja should give to the British 1 horse and 12 shawl goats of approved breed and 3 pairs of Kashmir shawls. Later it was amended to, you know, 2 shawls and 3 rumals, handkerchiefs. This was the, you know, this was the agreement with the British. It was to this throne that Maharaja Hari Singh ascended in 1925. So before I start speaking about Maharaja Hari Singh's reign, let us discuss the geography of Kashmir. If you have the map of Kashmir, map of India, it will be very helpful, you know. See, Kashmir's boundary, you know, eastern side, Tibet, of course, Tibet is there. Earlier it was, you know, it was not with China Hari Singh was there. Northeast was, of course, the Xinjiang province of China. Northwest was Afghanistan. In fact, Afghanistan, it's like a small, you know, pencil. And above that was the then Soviet territory of Tajikistan. In fact, now today is Tajikistan. It was Soviet territory at that time. And Kashmir itself, the valley was at the center. South of the valley is Jammu. And north was the Gilgit Baltistan province. Eastern side is Ladakh. And western side is Punjab and NWFP. In 1947, the connection between the rest of the Indian subcontinent and Kashmir was largely through Punjab, that is the present day Pakistan and Northwest Frontier Province. The distance between Rawalpindi and Srinagar is around 170 kilometers, whereas from Jammu to Srinagar is around 270 kilometers. Muzaffarnagar is only 125 kilometers from Srinagar. So the Kashmir Valley was dominated by Sunni Muslims. They were, of course, they belong to the Sufi tradition of Sunni Muslims, and they spoke Kashmiri language. The area which was jutting into Punjab and Northwest province, the Poonch, the so-called the Neelam Valley and the Poonch area, this area was dominated by Punjabi Muslims, Pathans and other Muslims who didn't speak Kashmiri language. They didn't speak Kashmiri language, and they had a very strong military tradition. They course, they joined the British Army and fought in the Second World War. All this region, the Mirpur and Poonch, and the other region, which is adjoining the Punjab. This area was full of such Muslims. And of course, the Jammu Muslims also, they didn't speak the Kashmiri language. The Gilgit, of course, was full of Shia Muslims. The Gilgit area, Gilgit Baltistan area, was full of Shia Muslims. Of course, Ladakh was full of Buddhists. So Kashmir was both Jammu region, Gilgit region, and the Kashmiri Valley. All this, the three regions were Muslim majority regions. Ladakh, of course, the population was very, very less. Ladakh was a Buddhist majority region. The Gilgit administration was temporarily taken over by the British in the 30s, when they felt that the Soviet Union would pose a threat to Kashmir. The Gilgit scouts were formed, and a British officer was appointed to supervise them, and they were very, very well trained. You know, the Gilgit scouts were very well trained, and the administration was also with the British. But when the June 3rd plan of India's independence plan was announced, the entire Gilgit scouts, and the British officer, they all came under the Maharaja, because the Gilgit was again handed over back to the Maharaja because of the lapse of paramountcy. The British did not have any paramount interest in that region, so they handed over the thing to Kashmiri Maharaja. Now, if you have a map of Kashmir, you will know some of the important names of towns I am going to mention in my speak. These names are, first you take Muzaffarabad. This is now in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. And Rawalkot and Bimbar, they were all on the Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. And the Indian side, you have Baramulla, and then Baramulla slightly inside, then Uri, then Poonch, then Rajouri, then Nowshera. Okay, that is from north to south. These are the towns about which I am going to mention in my talk. So keep this in mind. All these towns are west of Srinagar, and the war in Kashmir took place largely in this area, and of course on the top was Skardu, which was in the Gilgit region. There also the war took place. Now Maharaja Ranjit Singh was, like other Maharajas, a playboy. He was more interested in races. Most of his days were spent in Bombay race courses. Okay, he was not interested in the administration of Kashmir. But he had a set of, Hindu prime ministers who were ruling Kashmir. The complaint had always been that the Muslims were shortchanged during his regime. For instance, take the case of Sheikh Abdullah. Sheikh Abdullah was a graduate from Aligarh Muslim University. And during those days, getting a degree was very, very rare, especially among Muslims, and that too Kashmiri Muslims. But believe it or not, Sheikh Abdullah did not get a government job. He spent his initial days as a teacher. There are about 450 officers in the JNK cadre, and about 40-50 officers were Muslims. The rest of them were all Hindus. The peasants were suppressed. The traders were suppressed. There's no freedom of speech or anything. So whenever people agitated, they were simply killed by the Dogras, the Dogra army of Maharaja of Kashmir, the Hari Singh. So this prompted the Muslims to organize politically. Of course, I will not go into the history of how the Muslim politics developed in Kashmir. I am not going to that. Suffice it to say that Sheikh Abdullah started his Muslim conference in 1932. Sheikh Abdullah, of course, was attracted towards Mahatma Gandhi's views and Jawaharlal Nehru's politics. So he changed the name of Muslim conference into National Conference in 1939, and he had a very close relationship with the Nehru family during all these years, and he was a keen observer of Indian politics, and he was fiercely secular. He wanted Kashmir to be secular, and he had the support of the Kashmiri people during that time. There is absolutely no doubt about that. In 1946, he started Quit Kashmir movement, which resulted in his imprisonment, and it was suppressed brutally by the Maharaja's forces. When independence came about, that was the Indian independence and the Pakistani independence came about. The Muslims of Poonch, they staged a rebellion around 15th August 1947. This was also brutally put down by the Maharaja and the Dogra troops. Many Muslims were killed in the Poonch town and surrounding the areas surrounding the Poonch town. So then what happened was, there was another huge massacre that took place in Jammu. Of course, this happened later, but I had to mention, otherwise I'll forget, you know. When partition happened, many Hindus from Punjab, they poured into Jammu, and Muslim and Hindus from the Poonch area also, they came to Jammu, which resulted in riots everywhere. And with the help of, you know, with this Sheikh Abdullah says in his Atishi Chinar that the Maharani was actively involved, and Merchant Mahajan, the Chief Minister of Kashmir, was also actively involved in the butchery of Muslims of Jammu. Thousands and thousands of Muslims were simply killed. This happened, of course, in September, October 1947. In fact, the population of the Jammu, it became, you know, the Muslims became minority there. Many, of course, they moved over to, many were either killed, they moved over to Pakistan. The Poonch rebellion and the suppression, you know, led Pakistan to believe that Kashmir may not join Pakistan. So they wanted to have a contingency plan. This plan was called Operation Gulmarg. This was prepared by Colonel Akbar Khan of the Pakistani army, and he was supported by some Muslim officers who were earlier with the INA, Indian National Army. You know, they helped him, you know, draw up this plan. This plan was prepared, and Jinnah knew about this, Liaquat Ali Khan knew about this, and they were waiting and watching. Okay, they, of course, they wanted to send the Pathans of Northwest Frontier Province into Kashmir. Okay, they had Pathans trained and they were kept ready. Now, when independence, just before independence, when the June 3rd plan of Indian independence was announced, Mountbatten made a visit to Kashmir Valley. He and the Maharaja were good friends. So Mountbatten had a 2 or 3 days discussion with the Maharaja, and he explained to him in very clear terms. He said three important things which we should all, you know, remember. He said independence was not an option. Kashmir should either join India or Pakistan. If the Maharaja chose to join Pakistan, India would not take it amiss. This is second point. The third point, the most important point, was this. Mountbatten said very clearly to the Maharaja that he had the personal assurance of Sardar Patel that India would not take it amiss if Kashmir joined Pakistan. He gave this assurance to the Maharaja. But the Maharaja was dithering. He was dithering because his heart was with India. Sheikh Abdullah had very close relationship with the Indian leaders, and he didn't want to have anything to do with Pakistan. You know, Sheikh Abdullah did not want anything to do with Pakistan, and majority of the people were with Sheikh Abdullah. But his problem was that Kashmir was economically very closely linked with the Pakistan region of Punjab. The entire economy of Kashmir was then based on the timber trade, and the timber route was on the rivers, you know, which all flew into Pakistan. So the economic connection was so close that the Maharaja was not able to decide. In fact, he wanted to, given a chance, he could have remained independent. You know. But independence was not possible, and he did not have either the political power nor the military power to declare independence. So he was procrastinating, he was delaying, you know. He said, tomorrow would be a better day, you know. But what he did was, he signed a standstill agreement with the Pakistan administration. The standstill agreement means that whatever agreement he had with the British Crown would still be valid with the Pakistan government. He did not sign any agreement with the Indian government. Because India was prepared to wait and watch. India said, whatever you decide, we would agree. That was the stand of India. That was the stand of India. And as V.P. Menon said, we didn't have time even to think about Kashmir. We had so many other, our plate was, you know, was overflowing. So we didn't bother about Kashmir at all. That is what V.P. Menon says in his book. Now, India at that time, we should remember, India at that time did not have a proper land route to Kashmir. Okay, because Gurdaspur was the only way through which India could reach Kashmir. And Pathankot, but that was given by Radcliffe later. No, in August 15, we didn't know the Gurdaspur Tehsil will come to India or not. We didn't know that. Okay, when Gurdaspur came to India, we had a land route to Jammu and Kashmir, which was not the case with Pakistan. With this, you should remember, because Pakistan, the Pakistani side of Punjab, had a very good road into Kashmir, the Jhelum Valley Road, you know, which connected Rawalpindi to Muzaffarabad and Srinagar, was in operation for quite some time. Okay, that was the road everyone was using prior to independence. This you should remember. Now, Pakistan, you know, see, I will tell you the position of Kashmir. Kashmir was economically, you know, helpless. Though there was a standstill agreement with Pakistan, Pakistan tried every trick to make Maharaja accede to Pakistan. So it stopped supplying him fuel. In fact, the Maharaja wanted 5,000 gallons, believe it or not, 5,000 gallons of fuel. Pakistan refused to supply 5,000 gallons of petrol. India was able to airlift fuel. India was able to supply only 500 gallons of fuel, which is how much now? 2,000 liters. That was to save Srinagar from coming to a standstill, you know. They used the petrol available to Srinagar at that time was only 2,000 liters. So what happened was, Jinnah was getting impatient. And the plan was also, the training of the Pathans are also going in full swing. And the Indian intelligence at that time, you know, they had a whiff of it. They had a source, you know, one officer came from Northwest Frontier Province. He came to, I think Kohat, from there he came to India. And he also spoke to the Indian intelligence officers about the plan that the Pathans are going to attack Kashmir. But the Indian intelligence at that time was almost nothing, you know, they didn't have anything. The British intelligence, before they left India, they destroyed every important document that was available with them. We had a few papers connecting to Assam, and we didn't have anything at all. We only had tables and chairs. Our intelligence was that bankrupt at that time. So the Indians at that time had to start from the scratch. So when this intelligence input came to the Indian army, they didn't take it seriously, because most probably not because they didn't want to, you know, they erred intentionally. They, at that time, because of the Poonch rebellion, there was skirmishes all over the border. The border between Kashmir and Punjab, how many, is about 800 kilometers, you know, the 800 kilometers border. There were always some skirmish somewhere it was taking place. So they didn't take this, you know, this intelligence input very seriously. But what happened was, since the Maharaja was not deciding, Jinnah took the decision to invade Kashmir. So on 22nd October 1947, he sent about some, say, 5,000 or 7,000 or 8,000, okay, less than 10,000 tribal people from Northwest Frontier provinces, the Pathans of, you know, Afridis, Wazis, Mazus, and Swatis, and also some Pakistan soldiers were supposed to be on leave. So what they did was, they were assembled in Abbottabad. You know Abbottabad? Abbottabad was a place where Osama bin Laden was, you know, hiding. You know, so that name should be familiar to you. From Abbottabad, they descended on the Jhelum Valley Road, and after capturing Domal, they arrived at the gates of Muzaffarabad. Now, Muzaffarabad was being guarded by a regiment of Kashmiri, the JNK force, which was with the Kashmir, with the Maharaja. Lieutenant Colonel Narayan Singh was commanding the the Kashmir forces. A few days ago, JNK government asked him, are you happy with the Muslim soldiers of your army, your force? Are they loyal? And this officer said without batting an eyelid that they are more loyal than the Dogras. But what happened was, as soon as the Pathans and the Pakistanis arrived, the Muslim soldiers of the JNK army deserted and killed Lieutenant Colonel Narayan Singh. He was the first casualty, major casualty of this inroad of the Pathans. Then what happened was, there was another great officer called Brigadier Rajinder Singh. Brigadier Rajinder Singh had about 200 loyal soldiers. With these 200 loyal soldiers, he destroyed a bridge near Uri, and he kept engaging this Pathans for more than 2 days. Okay, finally he was cut to pieces, and Brigadier Rajendra Singh was the first officer to be awarded Mahavir Chakra by the Indian government. Later, of course, this happened later, but he died. You know, he was one of the very senior officers who died there. One of the senior officers who died. Okay. And on 24th, the Pathans, they captured the Mahura power station, and the entire Srinagar was plunged into darkness. So their idea was to celebrate Eid, which was falling on 26th October, was to celebrate Eid in Srinagar. But what happened was, when they entered Baramulla, they wasted 3 days in Baramulla, looting, raping and destroying. They raped nuns of, a charity hospital in the city, and they killed all the patients, and they killed National Conference leader. You know, there was a leader by the name of Sherwani, and who, of course, was staunchly against these Pathans. He was organizing resistance against these Pathans. So he was, in fact, crucified in a church in a most brutal manner. So when the Maharaja came to know of this, he became panicky. So he immediately sought help from India. In India, the Defence Committee was held immediately. The Defence Committee had, the CNC, Mountbatten, then General Lockhart, was the head of the Indian Army, was leading the Indian Army, Jawaharlal Nehru, Sardar Patel, Sardar Baldev Singh. Okay, these are the major, players in that Defence Committee. These dates are very important. 24th, the Maharaja gives a request. 25th, the committee is held. The committee immediately deputes V.P. Menon to Srinagar. V.P. Menon flies to Srinagar on the 25th. He finds the airport completely deserted, and the roads are all deserted, but for the National Conference volunteers were there with lathis and standing at corners. Okay, so when he meets the chief minister of the prime minister, at that time they're called the prime minister of Kashmir, Merchant Magajan, he was totally nervous. He had a nervous breakdown, and with great difficulty he takes him to the Maharaja Hari Singh. So he asks Hari Singh as to what are you going to do. So Hari Singh, again, he is dilly-dallying, he is not able to decide. When he finds the situation to be very precarious, he immediately asks the Maharaja to move immediately to Jammu. He tells him that if you stay in Srinagar, you will be cut to pieces in no time. You know, these guys may land here any time and your life will be in danger. Please go to Jammu. So that night, he stays in Srinagar. The next day morning, he returns to Delhi. That is on 26th morning, he returns to Delhi. V.P. Menon says that, it's very difficult. It was very difficult for him even to get a jeep. With great difficulty, he arranges his jeep, and he goes to the airport, flies his aircraft, and gets into the aircraft, and he returns to Delhi. In Delhi, he immediately goes to the Defence Committee meeting is on. He immediately goes to the meeting, and the meeting, Mountbatten says that India cannot send its army to Kashmir, because there is no treaty with Kashmir, number one, and Kashmir is an independent country, and if India wants to enter Kashmir, it should have some sort of an agreement with Kashmir. So he says the Maharaja should accede to India. Maharaja accede to India on the condition that a plebiscite will be held in Kashmir, Jammu and Kashmir, and Sheikh, yeah, responsible government will be established, of course, with Sheikh Abdullah as the at the helm of affairs. So he said that you return to Jammu, meet the Maharaja, and get him to accede to India. So VP Menon, as of course his template is there of the instrument of accession. So what he does, he flies to Jammu on 26th. He flies to Jammu, he finds the Maharaja fast asleep, because he was traveling the all night to reach Jammu. He was tired. So the Maharaja is woken up and he agrees to sign the instrument of accession. So on 26th, some historians say that the instrument of accession was signed only on the 27th. But actually, the V.P. Menon says, in his book, that it is signed on the 26th October 1947. Let us take that as the date. So with this instrument, he immediately returns to Delhi. Sardar Patel is waiting at the airport to receive him. Okay. So what is important is, at that time, Sheikh Abdullah is also in Delhi. He is also in Delhi. Okay. Finally, it is decided that an infantry battalion will be sent to the very next day to Kashmir. Okay. Sheikh Abdullah also agrees to this. This is very, very important. He also agrees to this. Still, Mountbatten and the British, the chiefs of staff, General Lockhart, or all the persons, they were reluctant. They say the risk is very, very high. Okay. The operation, we don't know what is going to happen. But do you know who put his foot down? It was Jawaharlal Nehru. I will read what V.P. Menon says in his book. He says this, this is for, especially for those clowns who think that Nehru was indecisive at crucial moments. This is what V.P. Menon says in his book. But Nehru asserted that the only alternative to sending troops would be to allow a massacre in Srinagar, which would be followed by a major communal holocaust in India. He said, I cannot watch a massacre to take place in Srinagar, which will, in its train, will cause a huge holocaust here in India. He also rubbed it in. He said to these British guys that the British residents of Srinagar would be killed. Every one of them will be killed by this tribal guys. You should remember this. So with Nehru overruled them, and the next day India started sending its troops into Srinagar. How did they send this troop? This is one of the biggest and the most heroic sagas of India's military history. About 100 civilian and IAF, at that time it's called Royal Indian Air Force, aircraft was arranged. And our soldiers were flown into Srinagar. In fact, Mountbatten was so amazed that later in an interview, he said, Mountbatten, he was the theater commander for the entire Asia at that time. He had seen Second World War at the very close quarters. He's no spring chicken. So he says, Mountbatten said, in all his war experience, he had never heard of an airlift of this nature put into operation such a short notice. This was done by Indian civilian pilots as well as Air Force pilots. So now let me come to the war that took place in Kashmir. The war between India and Pakistan lasted till 31st December 1948, which means about 14 months there were battles. Many were won by India, some were lost by India. I would only speak about some of the most important battles, that turned the tide in favor of India. Of course, one battle which turned the tide in favor of Pakistan, which I will come to it later. Anyway, in fact, one of the first set of officers to be airlifted was Ranjit Roy. Ranjit Roy was commanding a Sikh regiment here in Gurgaon. In fact, he was about to hand over charge because he was selected as the military attache for Washington. In fact, okay. So, but war came about and he flew into Srinagar. When he flew into Srinagar, his immediate aim was to attack Baramulla. Then he found that the number of Pathans and the Pakistani regular soldiers were too many. So he took a defensive portion and a tactical high ground near Pathan. I think in Pathan he took a tactical high ground. So there he held on to that position, and he wouldn't allow the tribal to enter, you know, to cross Pathan. Finally they were cut down to pieces, and he lost his life. It is because of his defense of Pathan which made the tribals and the Pakistani fear that there are many more Indian soldiers here in Srinagar. So Srinagar could not be taken that easily. So they waited. They didn't attack Srinagar immediately, so they waited. This wait was, you know, very helpful to India, because India could move in more soldiers by that time. You know, more soldiers, they airlifted more soldiers into Srinagar by that time. So at that time, Lionel P. Elpison was given the command, the Brigadier L.P. Singh was given the command. And he could fight and retake Baramulla by 8th November 1948. It was during this period that Major, all these names, Major Somnath Sharma, was the first Paramveer Chakra Award winner. He made his supreme sacrifice, he was also surrounded by thousands of Pathans. He had about 50 or 60 soldiers, but he killed many people, and he fought till the last moment. Okay, it was he who saved the Srinagar airfield from being occupied by the enemy. So for that act of valor, he was awarded Paramveer Chakra. Okay, so when Sen went to Baramulla, you couldn't believe the rapine and the loot that had happened in that place. He returned in his book, Slender. It's a very nice book. If you have that book, please read that book. He says, our soldiers, they are all battle-hardened soldiers. They have seen deaths everywhere. They are all participants in the Second World War. Even they were shocked by the wanton butchery that took place in Baramulla. See, the war, in this war, there are so many battles were there. I don't want to bore you with the military details of this battle. But again, Lionel P. Sen was in Baramulla. He was about to go into Musafarabad. The Pathans were retreating, very fast. So he could even enter Musafarabad. Do you know what prevented him? What prevented him was the fuel shortage, The Indian Army's supply line was very, very thin, because everything had to be airlifted. So he didn't have fuel to reach Musafarabad, though it was for the taking. Then there's another important thing that took place in this war, which was that L.P. Sen, he was at the north, Baramulla, and Musafarabad is at the north, is towards northwest. So he is asked to come down to south to defend Poonch. Poonch was attacked from all sides by the Pathans. Okay, the town was under siege. The British officers of the Indian Army were reluctant to send relief to Poonch. They said that Poonch should be given up. But it was Jawaharlal Nehru again who said nothing doing. Poonch should be defended by all means. He overruled. This is a very important, point. Again, people are saying that Nehru did not take a decision. This decision, everyone says, even the military historians say that it was this decision of Nehru which saved for us Poonch and Nowshera and Rajouri. All these areas, was saved by India because of this decision of Jawaharlal Nehru. He, in fact, airlifted under 50 para brigade was headed by Brigadier Pritam Singh. He airlifted many soldiers. And what was more, this is also very important. Brigadier Pritam Singh was able to build an airstrip in Poonch with the help of 5,000 civilians of that area. So they were all helping India. The civilians were all helping India. Our air force was even able to fly artillery guns into Poonch. The Poonch blockade, was was there for more than was there for about a year, in fact. Okay, it was relieved only in October 1948. From November 1947 to October 1948, that city was under siege. Okay, in fact, VP Menon says this is even, you know, this siege was even worse than the Berlin blockade of 1948. You know, in Berlin blockade, the city was not starved or you know, were not bombarded, but Poonch was being bombarded. You know, so this is one of the greatest sagas of the Indian Army. With the very thin supply line, with great difficulties, they were able to save the city of Poonch. It was in this area that, you know, I should mention about Brigadier Usman. You know, Brigadier Usman gave his life and he won Mahavir Chakra defending US, because earlier he defended Nawar Shirab. He killed about 1000 enemy, and with the he had only loss of 33 persons, you know. Then he defended a place called Jhanjar. In Jhanjar, you know, he defended the place, and it's because of his defense that the Poonch was saved and Jhanjar was saved, and all these places were, you know, Rajouri was saved, in fact, because of that, you know, because of that attack. So Brigadier Usman was awarded Mahavir Chakra, and he lies buried in a Jamia Millia, I think. He is the senior most officer of the Indian Army. Of course, Brigadier Rajendra Singh was also, you know, was a senior officer, but he belonged to the JNK force. But he is the first senior most officer of the Indian Army to be given a gallantry award. You know, he was, you know, and then only other officer is Brigadier Hoshiyar Singh. Till now, if I'm not mistaken, only two brigadiers got gallantry award in the Indian Army. One is Brigadier Usman, the other is Brigadier Hoshiyar Singh, who got the award in 1962 war, if I'm not mistaken. I don't think Gargil, any brigadier, got any, you know, gallantry award. The siege of Poonch ended in a victory. But on the top, if you go to the Gilgit-Baltistan region, what happened there was also very interesting. The Gilgit Scouts was commanded by a British major called Brown. He was a rascal. What he did was, on 31st August 1947, that is after Kashmir legally acceded to India. Okay, it acceded either on 26th or 27th, whatever be the date. The Gilgit Scout, you know, the soldiers deserted with the influx of the Lashkars, the Pathans. Inside, from northwest point, from Pakistan, they came into Gilgit-Baltistan region, and the Muslim soldiers deserted, and this guy actively helped them. In fact, it was he who hoisted the Pakistani flag in his regiment, in the Gilgit Scout regiment. He should have been shot for treason, you know, really. But anyway, he escaped scot-free. You know, the times were such that nothing could be done to him. Okay, so what happened was, after Gilgit, these guys, they moved along to Skardu, which was held by Lieutenant Colonel Thapa of the JNK Army. Then later it was supported by India. Much as we tried, we were not able to, you know, to lift the siege. And finally, Lieutenant Colonel Thapa was taken as a prisoner of war, and most of his soldiers were simply, you know, butchered by this Pakistani army and the Pathans. Okay, so in this war, we gained a town and we lost a town, Skardu. If we had saved Skardu, maybe the Gilgit region also would have been with India. One never knows. You know, at least one portion of this would have been with India. This is the end of the military story of what has happened in Kashmir. One should remember that India fought in Kashmir with greatest odds. The most important thing is, which many of us do not know, India and Pakistan had one commander-in-chief. He was Field Marshal Aqil Naik. He was the commander-in-chief of the Indian Army. He was the commander-in-chief of the Pakistani Army. Okay, General Lockhart was looking after the Indian Army, and General Gracie was looking after the Pakistani Army. In both Indian Army and Pakistani Army, the senior officers were all Britishers. Okay, in fact, when Maharaja of Kashmir acceded to India, Jinnah ordered General Gracie to move Pakistani Army into Kashmir, the regular army into Kashmir. But Field Marshal Aqil Naik went to Lahore and told him told Jinnah that all British officers will withdraw from the Pakistani army. It was only after this threat was made that the regular Pakistani army was not sent into Kashmir in October 27, 1947. So things are not, you know, black and white. You know, people who blame the British, no, they also acted, you know, at that time of crisis, they also acted almost impartially, I should say, the field marshal, you know, he acted impartially at that time. Okay. Now, the diplomacy at that time, you know, its path is very tortuous. You know, it went here and there and all. I am not going into the entire, you know, the entire jing-bang of diplomacy. But what was there in the mind of Indians right from the beginning, you know, I will give some idea of it. You know, the first joint statement between India and Pakistan was prepared by V.P. Menon. Do you know what? I will read a portion of the statement that will give an idea of the thinking of the Indian side. You know, it says, the question whether the state should finally accede to one or the other of the dominions. The two dominions were India and Pakistan. Okay, he was talking about these dominions. The question whether the state should finally accede to one or the other of the dominions should in all cases decided by an impartial reference to the will of the people, which means they were prepared to hold a plebiscite in Kashmir. This was the joint statement offered by V.P. Menon on behalf of India. Jinnah rejected it. Jinnah did not agree to it. Then it was told to him that the plebiscite will be under the supervision of United Nations. Jinnah again rejected that. Do you know why? There are two reasons. The first was that he was quite confident that the invasion would succeed, because he knew that the Pakistani supply line is very strong and the Indians will not be able to, you know, supply Kashmir, would not be able to supply Kashmir continuously. So the final victory would eventually be ours. This was what Jinnah thought. So that was why he rejected it. Secondly, his fear was that Pakistan must lose the plebiscite, because he knew, he was fully aware of the atrocities of the Pathans in Kashmir. The Pathans, I should make it very clear, they did not distinguish between Hindus, Christians or Muslims. They looted, they raped without any distinction. This was the truth. In fact, during the British time, the Pathans were being bribed every year. I think they were being given about to keep quiet, to not to indulge in criminal activities. They were being given about 15 crores or 20 crores or something like that. You know, the Pakistani government was not able to pay that money because the government was, you know, it was not very rich. They didn't have money at all. So this was additional source of income for the Pathans. You know, so they looted without any let or hindrance, and the Pakistan government could not do anything about it. You know, these tribes are all, you know, they were lost unto themselves. You know, that was very, very important. So this was the reason why Jinnah did not agree to this. Nehru then again offered, you know, the number of, I don't want to go into the dates, you know, the lot confusion. I will tell you what were offered. Nehru again said that the aggressors were from the Pakistani side. So the Pakistan should order the tribals and the Pakistani army to withdraw. Then the Indian army will also withdraw. We can have a plebiscite under UN supervision. This was also offered by Nehru. Again, this was rejected by Liaquat Ali Khan. So this was going on again and again and again and again. We should all remember that every aspect was discussed during that time. And in the discussion, both Sardar Patel and Baldev Singh participated. No decision was taken by Jawaharlal Nehru independently without consulting his colleagues. This is very, very important. What were the aspects of those who discussed? One was complete independence was also discussed. Letting the valley, you know, go. Keeping Jammu and Ladakh, that was also discussed. Letting the Azad Kashmir or the Pakistan occupied Kashmir go, that was also discussed. The other thing which was discussed was that When the situation in Kashmir deteriorated in around December 1947, the Indian forces were on the retreat. Poonch was, you know, was being threatened, and Srinagar was being threatened. The Pakistani side was on the ascendancy. At that time, India also thought in terms of expanding the war and start a new front on the Punjab, you know, on the Punjab side, on the Lahore side. You know, they also discussed this aspect. Okay, there was a general staff appreciation of the, you know, of the events that took place in 1947 December, and the army suggested that we are not in a position to start an all-out war against Pakistan. This was the appreciation given by the army headquarters to the defense committee, and the defense committee had no other option except to accept it. Of course, situation changed in 1948. We retook all these western towns which are now with us were retaken by the Indian army, you know, at that time. Okay, so the twice, you know, such general staff appraisals were made. So then India at that time had no other option except to refer the case to the United Nations. You know, the Indian government thought that the British, having been fully aware of what actually happened in Kashmir, would support India's stand. Nehru was very sure of it, that the British government would do it. But they did not do it. They betrayed India. Do you know why? The reason was, now many historians feel that British betrayed Palestinians in Israel during that period. It's a very crucial period. And the entire Muslim world was angry against British imperialism. So Noel Baker, the British envoy to UN, thought that if we take a stridently anti-Muslim line, anti-Pakistani line, it would not be appreciated by the Muslim world. Okay, so he thought that India was expendable, or India could be managed, but they thought that, which was not true with the Muslim world. The Muslim world at that time was seething, and everywhere they were revolt, and the British, no, they didn't want to upset them further. That was one of the reasons why they did not fully support India's stand in the UN. The UN, of course, there are so many resolutions, but the most important resolution is the Security Council resolution of 1947. You know, I don't want to bore you with the complete details. I'll only tell you the important clauses of that resolution. The resolution says that Pakistan had to vacate aggression. Okay. After Pakistan vacated the aggression, India should withdraw its forces, keeping a minimum number of force to look after the law and order in the place. Okay. Number three is plebiscite would be held by a plebiscite administrator. The other thing is all political parties should be called back, and they should hold ministerial posts during this time. You know, even the parties which are supporting, you know, the Pakistan, they should also be invited with Sheikh Abdullah. They would form a sort of a national government or a sort of a state. You know, everyone should be participate in the governing Kashmir. This was the decision. This was the resolution. And the other important thing is, the plebiscite administrator would be all in all. No, he would supervise everybody. Okay, and he will report to both the Indian government and the Pakistani government. This was the gist of the Security Council resolution, 21st April 1947, resolution number 47. This was the resolution. The resolution was rightly rejected by India and, of course, Pakistan, because Pakistan did not want Sheikh Abdullah anywhere near the picture, and Pakistan did not want, want to remove his troops from the area occupied by them. Okay, and India, of course, did not want another dictator to be there. The plebiscite administrator, he would act as a dictator. India did not want that thing. Okay, India wanted Sheikh Abdullah government to be there. You know, they wanted the plebiscite administrator to supervise only the election process, not the governing process of, you know, Kashmir. You know, which they thought would happen if this guy was given all the powers. They also did not want the Azad Kashmir, the Pakistan POK supporting guys to be with Sheikh Abdullah, and Sheikh Abdullah himself was, you know, was against it. In fact, at that time, Sheikh Abdullah was even against plebiscite. You know, he didn't even want, he was shifting his stand, you know, So India also rejected this, you know, this Security Council resolution. But what is important is the Security Council resolution, this resolution is the most important resolution. It says that Pakistan should vacate its aggression. That has not taken place until now. Pakistan has not vacated its, you know, its aggression. You know, that has not happened. So the question of plebiscite in Kashmir will arise only after Pakistan vacates its aggression. Okay, now let's come to 1948. So this was dragged on, you know, the Security Council. You should remember that by just simply by the reference of case to United Nations did not stop the war. The war was going on. Okay, people say that India should have pursued the war, but referred the case to United Nations. You know, that was the accusation against the government of India headed by Nehru. That's not in fact the case. The war went on. This resolution was on 21st April 1948, but the war was until 31st December 1948. Okay, so India and Pakistan, both of them, you know, were at that time tying with different ideas. So Jawaharlal Nehru again had a consultation with the army chief. The army headquarters again made another general staff appreciation. Okay, this appreciation was submitted to Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel when Nehru was in London. Okay, this is what Srinath Raghavan's book says. This is a very important passage, you know, which you should all, you know, we should all know. According to Srinath Raghavan, the army headquarters assessed that an overall military decision is no longer possible. In Nehru's absence, General Boucher, who was the chief of the Indian army, submitted the appreciation on the possibility of evicting Pakistani forces and the tribesmen. He said the only effective measure would be an attack into Pakistan, a course that carried the unacceptable risk of escalation. Patel agreed. So these are all facts, you know. These are all facts. Okay, so you should know what facts are before accusing anybody. Okay, Pakistan in fact thought that India was, this was the decision, but Pakistan thought that India was about to launch a major offensive. So they decided to stage a counterattack on, they even fixed the date, 7th December 1948. But Liaquat Ali Khan, he persuaded, you know, the government. He said you delay the decision because ceasefire was possible. Okay, and finally a ceasefire was hammered out and it came into effect on 31st December 1948. Now, was an all-out war with Pakistan possible at that time? These are my views, these are the views of many historians also. An all-out war was not possible with Pakistan at that time because India was almost a pauper nation in 1948. Its problems are many. Secondly, India needed the support of the major world powers. Okay, no world power would have supported a war between India and Pakistan at that time. They would have tolerated skirmishes, but a major war, no world power would have supported, because the world was at that time was tired of wars, such wars, especially between two independent countries. Okay, the Indian economy would have nosedived at that time. The Indian economy would have nosedived at that time because of this war. What was more, Pakistan would then be fighting for its existence. And Pakistan army was not a pushover. Pakistan army was a strong army. You know, in 1947, when partition was made, 36% of the assets went to Pakistan, 64% was with India. The Indian army had 2.3 lakh soldiers only. We had only 2.3 lakh soldiers. We didn't have senior officials to command, you know, this army. We all had Britishers at very crucial positions. This was the state of affairs in India at that time. Okay, so the Pakistan army was not a pushover. Okay, they could have given a bloody nose to India because you were invading into the country. Okay, so the people would have also been against it. this would have created a huge Hindu-Muslim problem inside India too, because the entire nation at that time were, you know, were was at a boiling point. Okay, it would have created an Hindu-Muslim riots and many things at that time. Maybe India would have been torn asunder. So war in 1947-48, a total all-out war with Pakistan was not an option. Number two, India would have never been able to capture the POK, the Pakistan occupied Kashmir, you know, the areas, present areas in 1947-48 without incurring a huge loss, which loss rightly the Indian administration was not prepared to accept. That was the reason why India's case was referred to United Nations, and that was the reason why the ceasefire was accepted by India, and Pakistan also accepted the ceasefire. So this in short is the story of Kashmir. Again, let me tell you, an all-out war is not an option even today. An all-out war with Pakistan, with either Pakistan or China, is not an option at all. Even a limited war is not an option today, because we are, all three of us are nuclear power. So it is absolutely stupid to speak of India's glory and we will, you know, we will not, you know, will not tolerate any of our enemy incursion things. All these slogans are fine, but it is always better to sort out these problems through diplomacy rather than force. In 1947-48, India was compelled to use force, but our leaders had at the back of their mind, always they had the back of their mind, that if peace was a viable option, they will immediately accept peace. That was, you know, their view. And finally, when peace was offered, they accepted peace with both hands. Yes, of course, Pakistan occupation is illegal. As far as India is concerned, Pakistan occupation is illegal, because the Maharaja, the entire area belonged to the Maharaja of Kashmir, and he acceded to India. See, the other important point which I forgot to mention was that in September 1948, Hyderabad happened. You know, Hyderabad happened. Indian army marched into Hyderabad, and Hyderabad became, you know, a part of India at that time. Okay, the Pakistani army was, the Pakistani government was sure that, you know, the India would, you know, would keep offering peace, but given a chance, they will march into Pakistan. That was that was what, you know, they were afraid of at that time. So that was why they were also, you know, planning a counteroffensive against India. Fortunately, a ceasefire happened. You know, as far as I am concerned, Kashmir is not a disputed territory. Kashmir belongs to India with the proviso that Kashmir is a unique case. Okay, so the Kashmir people have been given certain concessions. Those concessions, you know, you should allow them to exercise those concessions. That's all I'm saying. The third party mediation was thrown out of the window when Bhutto and Indira Gandhi signed an agreement. So the third party mediation is dead as a dodo. In fact, the United Nations did not know much about Kashmir. Okay, the United Nations, in fact, the United States did not know much about Kashmir. But they, you know, as always, they followed the British line. Okay, and China, in fact, the resolution, the Security Council resolution, the original resolution was drafted by China. In fact, that was changed. That was changed by by the other members. Russia, of course, did not take part in this at all. Indian government has given a promise. You forget about Security Council. The Indian government has given a promise to the Kashmiri people that they will hold a plebiscite, they will hold a referendum. Okay, that they said, you know, that promise we have not fulfilled so far. Not only that, we gave a unique portion to Kashmir under Article 370. And we withdrew it unilaterally without consulting the people of Kashmir. Yeah. See, in 1947-48, the Britishers, they were behaving as if, you know, India was still their, you know, their fiefdom, you know, their So they could play ducks and drakes with India. Nobody would question, nobody would question them. That was how they were behaving. But unfortunately, on the military front, neither Jawaharlal Nehru, nor Sardar Patel, nor any of the leaders of India have any military experience. Even our soldiers, most of the army officers, they never had a major staff experience. Nobody had a staff experience. So we had to depend on the Britishers. There's absolutely, we had no other option at that time. Combat experience they had, they didn't have, that headquarters experience, the staff experience, they did not have. Combat experience they had. Many of them had combat experience. It's not that they didn't have combat experience. In fact, some of the guys who died there in Kashmir, they had they fought in several battlefields of the Second World War, Let us say Jawaharlal Nehru was not the Prime Minister. Sardar Patel was the Prime Minister of India. What would have happened, please imagine. There's no question of Sheikh Abdullah accepting Sardar Patel. If Sheikh Abdullah did not accept Sardar Patel, there's no question of the people of Kashmir accepting Sardar Patel. So the Maharaja per force would have decided to accede to Pakistan. This factor you should not forget, This factor of history you should not forget. If Kashmir had acceded to Pakistan, the Akshay Jain problem would not be there, would not have been there, the 1962 war would not have happened at all. So these are all the great ifs of history. One, if someone says, Nehru, Patel would have been different, but Kashmir would have gone out of India. Kashmir would not have even been with India if Patel had been the Prime Minister. So all these, ifs, we should not, worry about that at all. You should be concerned with what actually happened. If you want to understand history, don't go by anecdotes. Don't go by stories. Some guy would write that Manekshaw told this, or Sardar Patel told this to X and Y. Don't believe all these things, Believe in records, whatever is available on record. Or the actual player, like VP Menon is an actual player. So there should be some, trust in whatever he says. And Sheikh Abdullah is an actual player. If he had written something, and Jawaharlal Nehru has written to, in actual time has written to people. Patel had also written on file the recorded notes. You should go only by those records, not by anecdotes. Patel was, of course, many times, not only Patel, even Nehru was for a war against Pakistan. But it was the Indian Army which advised against it. And both Nehru and Patel accepted that. At that time, every Indian leader, including Patel, including Nehru, they worked in the interest of India. They thought that they were working for India, to the advancement of India. They might have made certain mistakes, but one should never suspect their intentions. They were, all of them, all our leaders at that time were made of better material. I have absolutely no doubt about that. The only way to resolve the Kashmir issue is to listen to the people of Kashmir. I am not saying that, you should take a decision in accordance with the people, whatever the people want. I am not saying that at all. But at least you listen to the people of Kashmir. At least go halfway. That's also not, you're not doing, For so many years, you have not done that. I blame both the Congress government as well as the BJP government for that.